501c3 status. What is a 501c3 designation? Section 501c3 of the United States Internal Revenue Code defines 29 types of nonprofit organizations exempt from some federal income taxes. A 501c3 nonprofit organization is exempt from federal income tax if its activities serve any of the following purposes: charitable, religious, educational, scientific, literary, testing for public safety, fostering amateur sports competition, or preventing cruelty to children or animals. The organization must not engage in profitable activities or perform any tasks that do not serve its tax-exempt purpose. Shareholder distributions are strictly prohibited. Normal corporations that are for-profit organizations normally have the ability to withdraw money at different times for the personal use of the shareholders or officers or directors. Compared to a small business, like a partnership or an LLC, where they have owner's draws, in corporations you have shareholders instead, and it's called a shareholder distribution. Also, at the end of the year when they file their taxes, the profits are distributed evenly or to a predetermined percentage to each of its shareholders, and that needs to be claimed on their individual taxes. With a nonprofit, since there is no profit for you to carry, shareholder distributions of any kind are prohibited. The statement that says must not engage in profitable activities again means you are not allowed to make a profit on any of your activities and use that for any personal purposes or to pay any of the directors. Nonprofits can be basically one of two types: associations or corporations. There are others, such as foundations, and you can also have nonprofits that are LLCs, partnerships, what have you. But for the purposes of booster organizations, you basically fall into unincorporated associations or incorporated 501c3 organizations. Associations are not required to register with the state and may not be eligible to receive certain government grants. Associations are not qualified charities under the U.S. tax code, which means that donors, whether individuals or businesses, may not claim deductions for charitable contributions on their federal income tax return. If your booster organization is not a 501c3 corporation, it is your duty to notify any donors to your organization that their donation may not be deductible on their Schedule A itemized deductions on their personal tax return. Nonprofit corporations are required to register with the state in order to operate as a recognized entity. All corporations must obtain an EIN from the Internal Revenue Service, even though it does not employ anyone. Applying for an EIN can be done in a matter of minutes on the IRS website, and the number will be provided immediately with an official IRS EIN assignment notice called the CP-575 sent to you via U.S. mail. Periodic information filings with the state are required upon request to maintain status as a corporation authorized to conduct business activities. Although not required, booster clubs should file information reports with the Texas Comptroller of Public Accounts each year to ensure that the list of officers is always up to date. Officers often change from year to year compared to other for-profit corporations. One agent, band director, or coach should be identified with the Secretary of State and updated as necessary. Most nonprofit organizations, except faith-based organizations, government corporations, certain state institutions, and subsidiaries covered under a parent organization's group filing, are required to file a federal income tax return every year, even though no tax is due. And this is one of the main misconceptions, because volunteers usually assume that since they are tax exempt that they didn't have to file an income tax return, and that is not true. The purpose of reporting annual return is so that the IRS can evaluate your financial activity, your gross receipts, everything you're bringing in, what donations are coming in and from whom, and where your expenditures are going. Failure to file federal income tax returns may result in penalties, interest fees, and forfeiture of the organization's 501c3 status. So we're going to go step by step on creating a 501c3 corporation in Texas. First, you need to form a nonprofit corporation under Texas state law, the Texas Business Organization Code, BOC. First step is to choose the initial directors for your nonprofit. In Texas, you must have at least 3 directors on your board unless your nonprofit is managed by members instead of directors. The incorporator can be a natural person 18 years old or older, a corporation, or another legal entity. The incorporator is basically the person or entity that is filing your paperwork to create the organization. And when they say directors, that term can be interchangeable with officers on the booster executive board. Step 2 is to choose a name for your Texas nonprofit corporation. The name of your nonprofit corporation cannot be the same as, deceptively similar to, or similar to the name of any existing domestic or foreign entity, or any name reservation on or registration filed with the Secretary of State. To see if your proposed name is available, you can check the SOS Direct online directory for a small fee on the Secretary of State website. You can also email or call the Secretary of State's office to request a preliminary name availability check. And all these resources will be provided on this webpage and on a separate post. Step 3 is to prepare and file your nonprofit articles of organization, or as the state of Texas calls it, certificate of formation of a nonprofit corporation. You create your nonprofit entity by filing Form 202, Certificate of Formation, Nonprofit Corporation, with the Texas Secretary of State. Your certificate of formation must include basic information such as that provided for traditional for-profit corporations. Nonprofits planning to apply for 501c3 status must also include language required by the IRS to be granted such status, and this required language is not included in the paperwork provided by the state. So it's important for you to research that and make sure you have that language included. This includes a statement of purpose that meets IRS requirements, statements that your nonprofit will not engage in prohibited political or legislative activity, and a dissolution of assets provisions dedicating your assets to another 501c3 organization upon dissolution. Form 202 must be submitted in duplicate, 2 originals, along with a $25 filing fee. Complete instructions are provided in the first 5 pages of Form 202. Step 4 is to prepare your bylaws for your Texas nonprofit corporation. Before you file your certificate of formation, you'll need to have bylaws that comply with Texas law. Your bylaws contain the rules and procedures your corporation will follow for holding meetings, electing officers and directors, and taking care of other corporate formalities required in Texas. Your bylaws do not need to be filed with the state. They are your internal operating manual. However, you do need to have them available to the public upon request. Step 5, hold a meeting of your board of directors. Your first board meeting is usually referred to as the organizational meeting of the board. The board should take such actions as providing the bylaws or approving the bylaws, appointing officers, setting an accounting period and tax year, and approving initial transactions of the corporation, such as the opening of a corporate bank account. After the meeting is completed, be sure to create minutes that accurately record the actions taken by the board. Step 6 is to set up a corporate records binder. You should set up a corporate records binder for your nonprofit to hold important documents such as your certificate of formation, bylaws, and minutes of meetings. The most complicated step in this process is applying for the 501c3 tax exemption from the IRS. And here is the process. Now that you have created your nonprofit corporation, you can obtain your federal and state tax exemptions. Here are the steps you must take to obtain your tax-exempt status. File your Form 1023 Federal Tax Exemption Application. To obtain federal tax-exempt status, complete and file IRS Form 1023 with the IRS. This long and detailed form asks for lots of information about your organization, including its history, finances, organizational structure, governance, policies, operations, activities, and more. It is very important to receive assistance from a tax professional familiar with filing Form 1023, as its accuracy is key to successfully obtaining 501c3 status. Any single error, whether entering incorrect information or missing any question or option on the form, may result in delays in the application process or even result in denial of tax-exempt status. The IRS states that processing the application can take anywhere from 2 to 12 months, but it is not uncommon for the application to take many months later, even years in some cases. IRS currently cites a backlog of more than 60,000 applications, with many of them pending for 9 months. An interactive Form 1023 is available online to assist you as much as possible if attempting to submit an application on your own. You will need all possible information on your organization available to successfully complete the form, including your certificate of formation with the required language. A user fee of $850 is applied to organizations with average annual gross receipts exceeding or expected to exceed $10,000 annually over a four-year period. $400 for organizations whose gross receipts have not exceeded or are not expected to exceed $10,000 annually over a four-year period. The organization may operate as a 501c3 while the application is pending, including the filing of annual Form 990 or Form 990EZ or N if due date arrives before the tax-exempt status is granted. Additional information, including complete line-by-line instructions for Form 1023, are available on the IRS website. As a quick update, the IRS recently announced the new simplified application called the 1023EZ, as I just referenced a moment ago. This form is available on irs.gov and is only 3 pages long compared to the 26-page standard Form 1023. As many as 70% of all applicants qualify to use the new simpler form. Most organizations with gross receipts of $50,000 or less and assets of $250,000 or less are eligible. Form 1023EZ must be filed online via the IRS's new pay.gov website, and a $400 user fee is due at the time of submission. The organization may operate as a 501c3 while the application is pending, including the filing of annual Form 990, 990EZ, or Form 990N, if due date arrives before the tax-exempt status is granted. Additional information, including complete line-by-line instructions for Form 1023EZ, are available on the IRS.gov website. And that is the link that I am providing on the website is to the instructions for Form 1023EZ, because it does include the required checklist for you to go through to determine that you are eligible for the simpler Form 1023EZ application. And the final step is to obtain your Texas state tax exemptions. You must apply to the Texas Comptroller of Public Accounts for an exemption from state sales, franchise, and hotel taxes. The easiest way to do this is to complete and file Form AP204 with the Comptroller of Public Accounts after you have obtained your federal tax exemption. Include a copy of your IRS exemption letter with your application, also called your affirmation letter. Organizations with 501c3 status are exempt from Texas sales and use tax for goods and services directly related to the organization's tax-exempt activities. However, submission of Form AP204 is still required to confirm eligibility and receive an exemption of the state's franchise tax. In other words, you don't get your tax exemption automatically upon receiving 501c3 status with the IRS. You still have to put in an application with the state. As I stated, the 1023 application is the most complicated step in obtaining your 501c3 tax exempt status. And as a quick tip, there is an easier method of getting your status by avoiding that step, and that is to join Parent Booster USA, because they offer or they have been granted by the IRS group status as a 501c3. Which means all you have to do is to pay a small fee to become a member of Parent Booster USA, and you automatically receive 501c3 status as a subordinate of Parent Booster USA. Parent Booster USA is a national booster organization that provides information, training, and help to set up and operate school support organizations, booster clubs, and parent-teacher organizations. The IRS has granted PBUSA Group 501c3 status. This means that other organizations with similar tax-exempt purposes receive automatic 501c3 status simply by becoming subordinate members. Any booster club organization can gain basic membership with PBUSA by first applying for an employer identification number, EIN, on the IRS website, then paying the $235 joining fee. You will have to provide your CP575 notice along with that. Annual renewal cost is $135 every January the 1st. If joining on or after October 1st, the first renewal fee is not due until the second following year. Booster clubs still need to follow the steps given to form a nonprofit corporation with the state and filing the state form AP204. But membership with PBUSA eliminates the need to apply for 501c3 status with the IRS. This means the Booster Club can avoid completing the complicated Form 1023, paying the $400 or $800 filing fees, and waiting the 2 to 12 months or longer to receive approval from the IRS. PBUSA also provides members-only resources, like Form 990 filing reminder notices, free informational webinars, and their new cloud-based record storage and bookkeeping software called PBUSA Briefcase. PBUSA also offers a Get Legal membership for $355 joining fee, $195 to renew annually, which adds other federal and state filing assistance such as applying for an EIN, incorporating your organization with the state, applying for sales tax or franchise tax exemptions, or even filing your IRS Forms 990 and annual state information filings. And they also have, for non-members without paying the fee, a page called Resources for Everyone that provides a lot of information, general information for booster clubs, including tips on budgeting, little information on 501c3 status and what it means, and some resources as far as insurance and liability and other items. So we highly recommend membership with Parent Booster USA. Once you receive your 501c3 tax exempt status, it's important that people be able to verify that status for your organization. Upon approval of 501c3 tax exempt status, the IRS will mail an affirmation letter to the address provided. This letter will need to be retained with the organization's records and may be requested by donors, vendors, or anyone wanting to verify the club as a qualified charitable organization, enabling them to receive a tax deduction for their contributions. The IRS provides an online verification service known as the Exempt Organization Select Check Tool. This tool allows you to quickly search for specific organizations that are eligible to receive tax-deductible charitable contributions, and those that were automatically revoked for not filing required tax forms on time, or who have previously filed Form 990N. Booster clubs that receive 501c3 tax-exempt status through group membership with PBUSA may not be found using the Exempt Organization Select Check tool unless their status was automatically revoked or they previously filed Form 990N rather than Form 990 or 990EZ. PBUSA members can instead verify their 501c3 tax-exempt status on the PBUSA website itself. You can quickly search for any organization included in their IRS Business Master file. PBUSA submits updates of its members to the IRS quarterly, which can take 6 months for the IRS to post online. Therefore, the PBUSA website is the best option for verification. When asked to present an IRS affirmation letter for your booster club, you must instead provide PBUSA's group affirmation letter and your PBUSA tax-exempt certificate provided by PBUSA. The PBUSA affirmation letter is proof of PBUSA's group status, and the certificate proves that your club is listed as a subordinate group. These documents should only be provided upon request. Normally, most vendors only require a Texas Sales and Use Tax Exemption Certificate found on the back of Form 01339. So, what is your club's current status? You should verify your club's 501c3 tax-exempt status annually to make sure there are no surprises. You should also check the status of your state franchise account on the Comptroller of Public Accounts website. If either of these is found to have not been properly applied or have been revoked for any reason, you will need to determine where the setup process went wrong or came to a stop, or why your status was revoked. If it is determined that the initial setup process was incomplete or incorrect, you will need to fill in the appropriate gaps immediately. If status is revoked by your federal or state government, you will need to contact the IRS, State Comptroller of Public Accounts, or Secretary of State to determine any remedy available to reinstate it. Operating as a 501c3 tax-exempt organization without having been approved or at least submitted an application is considered fraudulent activity and may subject your club to criminal charges and or severe fines. And what PBUSA recommends is, in investigating the current status of your booster club, is to actually form a committee to look into it. And they should be able to analyze the current state of the organization, identify the necessary steps to ensure continued compliance, and then, of course, to act on those so that your organization is not subjected to criminal charges or severe fines. State reporting requirements and annual information reports. Normally, nonprofit corporations are still liable for state franchise taxes and sales and use tax. After successfully filing your Form AP204 and receiving tax-exempt status from the state, you are then exempt from the state franchise tax and reporting. However, the Comptroller of Public Accounts may still request an information filing, a form that is used to update your list of directors and other organizational information. Since most booster clubs have one or more officers leave office each year, it is a good idea to file an information filing each year, although this is not required. Failing to file an information filing in a timely manner when requested by the state will result in forfeiture of the club's ability to operate in the state. Booster clubs should also file Form 401, Change of Registered Agent and or Registered Office, with the Secretary of State whenever there is a change in the registered agent for the club, for example, the band director or coach. Those are usually the recommended people to list as the registered agent because they are more likely to be around longer than any officer. A $5 filing fee is due at the time of submission of your Form 401. The Texas Comptroller of Public Accounts and Secretary of State have recently instituted online filing and payment systems to ease the process of meeting your tax filing requirements. The Comptroller of Public Accounts web file system can be used to file and pay sales and use and franchise tax, or file a no tax due and information filings in those systems. When first registering your corporation with the Secretary of State, They will send you a letter affirming your corporation's formation. That letter will include the club's 11-digit Texas taxpayer identification number and web file number beginning with the characters FQ. The Texas taxpayer identification number will always be necessary. The FQ web file number is needed when completing your initial new entity questionnaire. After completing that filing, the Secretary of State will mail you another letter containing a new web file number beginning with the characters XT. All future filings relating to the franchise tax system will require this new web file number. All filings through the web file system result in more accurate reporting and can help avoid penalties and interest by filing in a more timely fashion and faster processing, usually within 24 hours. The Secretary of State has a similar online solution called SOS Direct. This more recent system has recently been updated to include more electronic versions of forms, including the certificates of formation, annual statements, changes to agents and officers, dissolutions, closing of a booster club, and nonprofit corporation reports, and more. Forms are generally processed in 24 hours or less, and filing fees can be paid through the system. Federal reporting requirements. It is a common misconception that 501c3 tax-exempt organizations are not required to file a federal income tax return because of their tax-exempt status. The truth is that the IRS needs to be able to determine that the organization continues to qualify for 501c3 status. In order to make that determination, the IRS needs to know what the organization's gross receipts are and generally whether or not that income is being used for the tax-exempt purpose of the organization as approved. Nonprofits report this information to the IRS using Form 990, Return of Organization Exempt from Income Tax. Form 990EZ, Short Form Return of Organization Exempt from Income Tax, or Form 990N, also called the e-postcard, Annual Electronic Notice. Form 990 is the full form generally required for 501c3 organizations with gross receipts of $200,000 or more, or total assets greater than or equal to $500,000 at the end of their tax year. Subordinates of PBUSA may request that PBUSA include them in a group filing of Form 990. Form 990EZ can be filed by organizations with gross receipts of less than $200,000 and total assets of less than $500,000 at the end of their tax year, though they may opt to file the full Form 990 instead. Form 990EZ may not be used to file a group return. Organizations that normally have annual gross receipts of $50,000 or less must submit Form 990N if they choose not to file a complete Form 990 or Form 990EZ. The IRS will send you a reminder notice if you do not file your Form 990 on time. There is no penalty for late filing of Form 990N, but an organization that fails to file any variation of Form 990 for 3 consecutive years will automatically lose its tax-exempt status upon the filing due date of the third year. Organizations also lose tax-exempt status with the state of Texas automatically when such status is revoked on the federal level. All variations of Form 990 are due on the 15th day of the 5th month after the close of your tax year. Forms 990 and 990EZ can be filed electronically via an e-file provider. Form 990N can only be filed electronically online. PBUSA provides fill-in organizers for all three options on their website as an easy way for you to report all required information to them for the purpose of completing your federal filing requirements for you. Filing fees for basic membership groups is $50 for Form 990N, $300 for Form 990EZ, and $500 or more for Form 990, depending on its complexity. Their Get Legal and Stay Legal membership group memberships fees include filing assistance at no extra charge, so it's included in your joining fees.